next speaker. They will talk about geoengineering, tuning Earth thermostats to cooler temperatures by Professor Dr. Dan Rosenfeld at Israel University.
Thank you very much, and Bill, thank you for the great overview. I will now focus on the geoengineering method that, in my view, relatively, I emphasize, is the most practical and gives the most bang for the buck. And that is affecting not necessarily by the Tumi effect, but the cloud cover effect, which I will show why I think it's so potentially powerful. Until now, mostly the Tumi effect has been considered not only in geoengineering, but in the general climate change community, and you see that there is cloud forcing term is only relating to the cloud albedo effect and not on cloud cover effect. And in that same meeting in Frankfurt, when I asked why don't we have the cloud cover effect, the answer was because we just don't know enough about it. Okay? So let's learn a bit about it. So before that, the idea to enhance the albedo by the Tumi effect was first credited, published by John Latham already in 1990 in that publication, and very recently one of these papers that he has been publishing with his colleagues calculated that in order to achieve global annual mean radiative forcing of only minus 1.13 watts per square meter, it is necessary deliberately quadrupling the cloud droplet number considerations in the subtropical maritime cloud. And that's quite a feat, and it is very hard to achieve just by the Tumi effect. So again, let's consider the cloud cover effect. And the cloud cover effect comes very simplistically when cloud in marine supercumulus is running out, and then we have less cloud cover. And that is actually observed, I'm suggesting, by what is called pockets of open cells, or POCs for brevity. The term was coined by Bjorn Stevens, I think. Here we are looking at several hundred kilometers of marine cumulus. The warm clouds that are raining out look like that. These are photographs taken by Joe Prospero in Barbados. You see the protocumulus raining out and not themselves out of existence. I'll go here quote the results of Project DICOM that was published in BAM, already published, not in press. There was area of POC and the aircraft with down-looking radar was flying over the solid cloud area and over the POC. And between point A and point B there were the POC, A and B. And you see that the clouds in the POC are intermittent, and where they occur they drizzle heavily, and otherwise they hardly drizzle at all. And as shown by quite a few people, the minimum depth for heavy drizzling of the cloud that is dependent on the cloud drop number concentrations and on the cloud depth above their base. And this heavy line of border of drizzling is where just by because there are so few cloud drops, just by diffusional growth you reach the drizzling side. And then the light drizzling, or not that heavy, occurs when you add the coalescence in diffusion. And again, going to DICOMS 2, in the looking at with a geostationary satellite along the time and over the open cells, you can see here the the aerosol concentrations of the aerosols greater than 0.1 microns. That was also with the measurements in situ there. Whenever they had the heavily drizzling, not surprisingly, the aerosol concentration went down to a few tens per cc, and then in the non-drizzling they were high. Now focusing with a high resolution that is modest 250 meter image on one of the scenes, there you see the sharp transition between the closed cells and the open cells, and it looks like really benign cellular convection, pretty much like achieved in a laboratory experiment. And here the fluid is being cooled from the top, and therefore the rising motion is the center of the cells, and the polygons are the downwelling branches of the fluid. And that's what occurs actually when you have marine stratocumulus, where the inverse convection is driven by radiative cooling from the top. Above the subtropical inversion, the air is extremely dry, so there is very strong radiative cooling, and you have the inverse convection, and the polygons are the downwelling parts, and in the middle you have the upwelling parts. The orange is the upwelling radiation, and these are the thin arrows are the air motion, and that can continue to occur as long as no substantial depletion of the cloud water occurs for whatever reason. But once you start drizzling, there is a cooling of the low level, starts the coupling of the marine boundary layer, and then gradually transiting from radiative cooling from the top to radiative cooling from the lower moist layer, the vapor radiates substantially, and then you reverse the whole situation by, instead of propelling the convection by radiative cooling from the top, it is rather warming from the sea surface, and therefore the whole flow is reversed from closed to open cells, and here it is clearly seen. And that is the mechanism that I've been suggesting and published it in ACP in 2006, is the major mechanism captures the mechanism of converting from closed to open cells, mediated by the dynamic response to the precipitation initiated by the difference in the aerosol. And once you have the more effective precipitation, of course, you are more effectively keep cleansing the aerosols from the boundary layer, and you self-maintain this mechanism. And you can have a runaway cleansing effect where there are too few aerosols to cause clouds, and then you have just a drizzle from the clear sky, which is a warm analogous to the diamond snow. And so let's look again at this scene with this in mind. Let's expand previously we saw only this area. Now we see that there are some shipwrecks, and the shipwrecks are composed of the closed regime, whereas the embedded in area otherwise is in the open cell regime. Now let's put the effective radius on that of the cloud drop, as inferred from the MODIS product, and you see that wherever and remember that the threshold for precipitation is about 50 microns effective radius, and if we look at the 50 microns, which is about this color, you see that all the solid cloud cover and the shipwrecks are with effective radius smaller than 50 microns of the precipitation or drizzling threshold, whereas all the open cells are with drizzling clouds according to this criteria. Now let's increase the picture, and you see it even more. And you see here the shipwreck, and now this frame is this red frame. Now we put it on the side because of different all the area, and you see that the shipwrecks are still evident by the reduced effective radius in the solid cover, which, and where the background is smaller than the effective radius, smaller than the precipitation threshold, but there is no effect on the cloud cover. Only when the background is larger than the precipitation threshold, the shipwrecks are actually forming clouds out of nothing. There is a positive feedback for maintenance of the closed nacelles, also as well as positive feedback for maintaining the open nacelles. I will not go into that for lack of time, but that is the reason why we are having a relatively sharp transition between those two regimes. And here we see the visible image, and we see that the visible reflectance is actually corresponding to the cloud amount of energy that is reflected back to space. You can see here that you can hardly see a much difference by the plume effect. There are some clouds that show something, some clouds that don't. But whereas you are in the broken regime, the radiative forcing is quite substantial. And here we are looking at the radiative forcing of the cloud. Here -162 watts per square meter, and between -33. So the difference is the net effective the net in this here the difference is -8 is 130 watts per square meter daily 24 hour average for the shipwreck, whereas in here it is much less. Can we practically cloud the CCN starved areas that are called these areas where clouds are not formed due to lack of CCN by deliberate seeding? And the answer is yes, we already do that in some places. Let's look, for example, at this particular situation, a surface high off western Europe. England, this is the Iberian Peninsula, and you see how the whole area is clouded by the shipwreck. Let's zoom on this area. You see with 250 meter resolution mobile satellite, you see how it works. And put that in animation using the Metrosat second generation so that we can have a substantial effect in some places. What is the potential forcing due to cloud in the CCN star area? Let's see what is the potential for this. Here I quote a publication of Rob Wood et al. From 2005, doing the statistics for the Southeast and Northeast Pacific Ocean over these areas. And the open cellular convection, the frequency of that is this much. The cellular does not organize this. So you see that there is a lot of potential of the open cells, that at least some of them might be closed if they are caused by starvation of CCN. To be fair, I should mention here that open cells form when you have dominant warming from the low level, from the bottom, or dominant over the cooling at the top, and that can occur also when cold air mass is going over a relatively warm ocean, but that is not likely to occur over the subtropical high. Again, going to Rob Wood, the cloud cover of his classified regime is about a point, the cellular are between 0.3 and 0.5 cloud cover, whereas the closed cells are about 0.9. So you see that there is a substantial difference in the cloud cover. And the frequency of occurrence of the open cells is about 25%, and the closed cells is about 20%. So there is a substantial potential here. But how much of this area should we really try to see them close the open cells? So suppose we want to decrease the global temperature eventually by 2 degrees in the distant future compared to what it would have been without that. then this requires the top of the atmosphere radiative forcing of -4 watts per square meter if we assume a conservative climate sensitivity of 0.5 degree per watt per square meter at the top of the atmosphere. This is equivalent to a negative forcing of -100 watts per square meter at 4% of the world surface area, which is about 20 million square kilometers. What does it translate to a shipwreck? Suppose that we want to have that much area in shipwreck. Then, suppose that after the shipwreck has enough time to spread after one day or so to 125 kilometers, then dividing this area by the width gives us the length of 160,000 kilometers of seeded length, track length. To cover that with ships that move 50 kilometers per hour, renewing it every 48 hours, it requires 66 ships. That's all. So it's not a fine sky, so to speak. So with what device, what would be those ships or airplanes or whatever can we see? Suppose that the seeding device, a hydrofoil ship, moves at 50 kilometers per hour while seeding at a rate that is required to fill a 175 kilometer width when it spreads out eventually with 50 N concentration of 1,000 per cubic centimeter in the NBL depth of 600 meters. By the way, it's enough to feed, eventually when it spreads with 150 N per cc. And this is a factor of 10. This means filling 10 to the 6th cubic meter per second with amount which amounts with this concentration 10 to the 15th ppm produced each second by a device. And if you go back to the device of Latham and Salter that Bill Cotton alluded to earlier, it could disperse the itemized 1 micron water droplets and the rate that they are actually advertising is 10 to the 16th, 10 to the 17th ppm per second, which is a factor of 10 to 100 more than is required for to achieve this. Well, here it is still a factor of 10 more than the minimum required. And this is the device. If you want, you can find that in the webpage. We might do it with other methods spreading the more conventional CCM, but that would be polluting. And I think that this is a great idea to use a natural material, and which has no environmental impact, at least as far as pollution is concerned. We will need 66 such devices to be operating at one time. And if we say one is about $10 million and we have twice that many, we can just for redundancy, then we are talking about operations that give order of magnitude of $1 billion a year, which Bill said that 20 or 30 billion a year is not much, that is even less. So that's, of course, we have ethical and practical questions. Bill expanded it, and just mentioned briefly what I think about it. Active cooling of the climate system is dangerous when done alone. It's like a drug addict getting more medicine that will keep him in shape until to be able to continue to do so more and more, increasing the dosage. Therefore, it must be used only as an interim measure for not crossing tipping points in the climate system, such as melting of the polar ice cap, in a program that aims, in a much better program that aims at decreasing the greenhouse gases to safe levels. Otherwise, if this is alone, I don't think that we should do it. because we are destined to the best consequences of warming a gas that, and we better have it gradually than suddenly when we stop doing the heating. The impacts and possible feedbacks must be tested in full earth simulation model before application can be considered. And so what are the next steps that should be taken here, I suggest, by the community? We need to calculate more rigorously this back on the envelope calculations with better quantification of the CCN starved areas. We need to go and study them, better calculations of the radiative forcing, and take into account the feedback using coupled GCN, more than GCN, which is actually an earth simulation model with all with the cryosphere, biosphere, and the hydrosphere. So that's after that. Thank you for listening. I agree. I'm painfully aware of that. The European Union has issued a call for geoengineering, and several projects will be funded. I responded to that with a group of with a consortium that includes GCM with a GCM modeler that and addressing those two points that you mentioned. First, simulating properly the seeding window, and second, addressing the simulation of the marine stratocumulus and including this effect in the GCM. Our major efforts in this proposal, and I hope that will be granted. Thank you. these are very appropriate comments, and I fully agree with that, and actually I think that this addresses that, this statement that we should not attempt it unless it is a part of a larger program that addresses the reducing the greenhouse gases. And by definition, it must be a globally agreed by international treaties. But this does not mean that we should not develop the knowledge base to serve the best decision in that race, and that's where we are now. Absolutely agree with that. Going back to the chart bar of the IPCC that showed in the first slide, the largest uncertainty with the bar is the bar that does not show the response of the cloud cover forcing. And if we do this right, we get the definition closer to the right answer to this the biggest unknown, at least as far as I think, in our understanding of the impact of aerosols and clouds on the climate system and possible climate prediction. So that is useful regardless of climate of geoengineering. I agree with you there. Yeah. That is now next October, right?
Time for a quick comment. Just under a minute left. With that, I want to thank all of you for joining again.